Good morning.
Good morning.
So good to see you all on this final Sunday in Lent, also known as Palm Sunday. We're so glad you're here today. We welcome you who are new visitors as well as those of you who are old friends. Welcome to those of you who have no church home, who need to find strength or to follow Christ, who have doubts or do not believe. Welcome to grandparents, mothers, fathers, and single people. Welcome to people of all colors, cultures, abilities, sexual orientations, gender identities, and gender expressions. Welcome to old and young, to believers and questioners, and welcome to questioning believers. Welcome to everyone, no matter who you are, whom you love, or where you are on life's journey, you're welcome here. And we're so glad that you joined us today. We hope that you find in this time of worship peace and uplift for your spirit. Before we begin, I'd like to offer just a couple of announcements. First, I'd like to thank those who are assisting me in leading our worship service today. For our acolyte, Madeline Macnick, for Deacons Judy Clark and John Diamasis, and for our musician today, Nare Yang, and for Christine McGarry, who is now coming in to lead our video production. Busted. We have lots of activities happening this week. You can read about these in the bulletin. I just want to highlight a couple of our Holy Week activities. Later on this evening, at 7 o'clock, you are all invited to come for our Easter cantata, as together in the sanctuary, we hear this wonderful musical performance led by Joyce Simpson, our choir, and friends. All are invited for this free concert, 7 o'clock tonight. On Thursday, we have a Maundy-Thursday service of Tenebrae beginning at 7 p.m. Our labyrinth will be open in Fellowship Hall at 6 o'clock if you'd like to come early to walk the labyrinth. The labyrinth will also be open throughout the day on Friday from 12 p.m. until 5. On Sunday morning, you're all invited to come for our Easter celebration beginning with an Easter egg hunt at 9:30 outside on the lawn. Little ones are invited to find the eggs, and bigger ones are invited to come and have fun watching them. And it's sure to be fun for all ages. So we invite you all to come and then stay for our worship service right here in the sanctuary at 10 o'clock. And one new feature that's not in your bulletin that I'm happy to announce is that we will have coffee hour in Fellowship Hall immediately following our Easter Sunday service. So this will be our first fellowship hour in Fellowship Hall in 2 years. So you are all invited to come and join us for this historic occasion. Sure to be fun for all. And now I invite you to stand as together we begin our worship service with our call to worship.
Good morning.
Oh, yeah. We'll come back to it.
We'll come back to it, okay. Good morning. Morning after morning, God grants us a new day. Wake up to the joys and challenges life presents.
This is the day that God has made.
God equips us to face whatever the day may hold. Watch and listen as God offers to teach us. We gather seeking a blessing in the name of God. We come thanking God for the gift of salvation.
God's steadfast love endures forever. Blessed is the one who comes in God's name.
And please join me in the unison prayer of invocation.
We stand together, mighty God, for you have sustained us through weary days and anguished nights. We join the shouts of welcome. Blessed is the one who comes in God's name. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. This is a day of celebration. There is joy in the air. We have witnessed the transforming power of Jesus' compassion. But there are ominous overtones. There are voices that say peace is a mirage and love will not endure. We cling to our faith that your steadfast love embraces life and death, that we are surrounded and upheld by your goodness. Meet us here, we pray. Amen.
We'll sing our first hymn, On Glory, Laud, and Honor, which is in the Black New Century Hymnal, number 216. I invite forward Megan Samborski, who is here to offer us a mission moment about the Boys and Girls Club of Stoneham.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak about the Boys and Girls Club of Stoneham today. I've had the pleasure of meeting many of you here at First Church, but for those of you who I haven't yet, my name is Megan Samborski, and I am the Director of Community Relations for the Boys and Girls Club of Stoneham and Wakefield. I also am a member here at First Church, and I want to say thank you to all of you for inviting my family and I into the community over the last several years. Both of them, all of them would be here today, but they're currently in a contentious battle with Linfield for a lacrosse title this morning, so we'll give them a pass. I wanted to start off by extending our sincere thanks to the Mission Committee and the First Church congregation for supporting our clubs and the youth that we serve every day in the Stoneham community. This donation contributes to our everyday mission to enable all young people, especially those who need us most, to reach their full potential. Many of us have heard of the Boys and Girls Club throughout our lives in some way or another. Maybe we went there as a kid, maybe we had a neighbor whose friends went there because their parents worked, or maybe we just attended an event or a fundraiser over the years. But many of us are unaware where it all began and what the history of the organization is. Boys and Girls Club of America had its beginnings way back in 1860 with three women in Hartford, Connecticut. Believing that boys who roam the street should have a positive alternative, they organized the first club. With character development as the cornerstone of the experience, the club focused on capturing boys' interests and increasing their personal goals. A cause was born. This cause has now evolved over the last 150 years into the club as we know it today, both nationally and locally. The Stoneham Club opened its doors in September 1973. Our organization has served generations of children and families alike over those last 50 years. Today, we operate two locations, our Stoneham Clubhouse, and just down the block, our new teen center. Just a block from here, which is amazing. Along with our Wakefield clubs, we provide fun experiences and educational programming to thousands of members after school and throughout the summer. We are proud to work with young people from a wide range of economic, social, and family circumstances, regardless of their gender, ethnic, and racial background. Just as we say here at church, all are welcome here. So what kind of impact does your support and donations make? On a larger scale, your support allows the clubs to financially operate every day after school and in the summer months. giving children in our community a safe place to go while their caregivers are at work, a place they can build lifelong friendships and be exposed to adult positive influences. It allows us to help families who may be struggling financially to attend the clubs, provide scholarships for children in Stoneham, and offer all kinds of inclusive programming, such as swim lessons, music, art, sports, STEM, and athletic programs. Support like this means that when unforeseen circumstances in our community arise, just like we experienced in the COVID-19 pandemic, we can rise to the occasion and really do whatever it takes to support local families. During the past 2 years, that meant delivering food and care packages to those experiencing difficult financial conditions, 3D printing PPE for essential workers, and families with health complications. It allowed us to continue our programming online and deliver very important social work to those young people who had to face unimaginable adversity in their transformative school years. I don't have enough time today to tell you all the thousands of ways that support like this means and what it does, but I can sum it up in a quote from a Stoneham Club Kid alumni. She says, "I started going to the Boys and Girls Club around age 7. My parents got divorced and the club really helped fill in the gaps living with a single parent. I absolutely loved being at the Stoneham Club. The adults were excellent role models and mentors, and they were so fair. I always felt that inside the club, you always got a fair shake, no matter who you were. That was more impactful than I could have ever imagined." That particular alumni went on to years of professional success, attending the Yale School of Medicine and later obtaining a doctorate in public health. She attributes the Boys and Girls Club in Stoneham to giving her that foundation of confidence to later pursue her adult aspirations. This particular testimonial really clearly reflects the vision of our organization, to provide a place where who you are, where you're from, and the circumstances that surround you don't determine your access to experiences or opportunities. And as that club alumni said, you get a fair shake no matter who you are. So thank you again from our club family to our church family for making a donation in support of those who enter our safe haven of our club doors each and every day. Through your support, the Boys and Girls Club are making that vision a reality every day in our Stoneham community.
We are grateful that you are among us today, and all the work that you do in the community is a blessing, not only to our church, but to so many here in Stoneham. Boys and Girls Club is a wonderful organization, and we are very glad to support them through our mission board. And you'll hear a little bit more about how you can support our mission board and all of the other good work that we are doing through them in the community a little bit later as we are beginning our stewardship campaign today. But now let us move into our worship service with our time of confession. Come all who are waving branches to welcome the Savior. When the light shines on us, we see the shadows we create. We sense our need for a faith more deeply grounded and a love more fully committed. I invite you to join me now in offering our prayer of confession. We confess, O God, that we identify with time's optimism and applause. We like a religion that makes us feel good. We prefer safety and security and certainty. Then Jesus comes, riding on a donkey, reaching out to outsiders, proclaiming humble obedience as a virtue, challenging powerful people to change their ways. We sense danger. When Christ upsets our craving for stability, we turn away from the risks. We do not want to be rejected or face a cross. We are not sure we really want to be Christians. Oh God, help us. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. God contends with us in our fears, identifies our rebellion, and transforms our contrition into courage. Our Creator does not give up on us when we are discouraged or reject us, when we get our pretensions out of hand. God, who exalted Jesus, is ready to forgive and lift us up. Christ walks with us on the way of faithfulness, empowering us to become the disciples we are called to be. And now I invite our young people to come forward for this morning's children's message. today is Palm Sunday, and if you've got one of these little palm leaves, wave our palm leaves here. Excellent. Or leaflets, I should say. These are leaflets. Now, we do this because a long time ago, one time Jesus came into Jerusalem. He came riding on a donkey, and when he came riding in, people had leaflets of palm, like you have here, and they were waving them. Not only that, they had jackets that they put down on the ground. Yeah. Pretty funny. It is a little funny. You don't see that every day, do you? Do you put your jacket in front of the car when you drive over it to keep your tires nice and clean? No. It would make your jacket a little dirty, right? Well, that's exactly what this group of Jesus followers did. They put their cloaks on the ground, and Jesus rode a donkey right on top of them. I'm sure that's what some of the people there were thinking. You know, and it was kind of a crazy thing to do. You don't see that every day. But it was a symbol of, you know, royalty. This is something that kings would do sometimes when they would show up to town. People would put their cloaks on the ground. So when the king came into town, he was walking on their cloaks and not on the dirty ground. And so when people did this for Jesus, it was a way of welcoming him as a ruler, as their leader. And the donkey didn't get dirty. And people waved branches like you have here. It was a big celebration. Now, have you ever seen a big celebration when someone comes into town or somebody comes into maybe like a sports stadium? Like the home team comes in and there's lots of people cheering and yelling and there's explosions because you've got fireworks and sometimes there's smoke and it's all exciting, isn't it? Like when the Patriots play at home, they come out of a tunnel under a big hat, like an inflatable hat. And it used to be Tom Brady that was running through there. Sorry, too soon. Yeah. But you have your hometown heroes and they run out onto the field, and when they run out onto the field, everyone cheers and it's so exciting. That was a lot like what it was when Jesus came into town that day. People were so excited, they were cheering and yelling, and it was so exciting because their hero came into town and they welcomed him among them as their leader. Yeah, some people weren't excited about that. Some people didn't like that at all. Yeah, so not everyone was happy about that, and some people actually, you know, did mean things to Jesus, certainly. But on that day, it was a big celebration. And so we remember that today. And next week, we'll talk about what happened later on that week. We'll talk about the good things and the bad things, and we'll talk about the best things. But today, we remember on this Palm Sunday that Jesus was welcomed as a hero. He was welcomed as their leader. So let us continue to welcome Jesus into our lives as our hero and as our leader. We do that when we give ourselves to Jesus. We do what Jesus wants. We love people and we show other people respect and kindness. That's how we can make Jesus our hero. We follow what he did. We make him our leader. Let's do that today and every day. Let's pray. God, we thank you for showing us how to live through Jesus, for coming to us and showing us how to live humbly, to give ourselves to others, to help people, to be loving. This day, we ask that you would guide us into doing that with all those in our lives, with the people we love, with our neighbors, and everyone in the world. Help us to be kind and loving, just as you were through Jesus. We pray this in the name of Christ. Amen. Now you and your palms may head out. Little ones are going to classes, and bigger ones are going to the extravaganza. You get to fill Easter eggs. And here in the room, we continue with our worship service with the hearing of Scripture from our reading from the Hebrew Bible.
I'll be reading from Psalm 118, verses 1 through 2 and 19 to 29. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever.
Thank you, Linda. Our gospel lesson today comes to us from the 19th chapter of Luke. Listen for God's word. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And when he had come near Bethpage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he had sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you. And as you enter it, you will find there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus. And after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. And as he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, order your disciples to stop.' But he answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out.'" These words are breathed into us by the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
Happy Cloak Sunday. Sounds a bit funny, doesn't it? Cloak Sunday. And yet Cloak Sunday might actually be a better name for this holy day based on today's reading from Luke, which doesn't mention palms at all. Cloaks, however, are prominently featured in today's story, being placed beneath Jesus as he sat upon the colt, which is specifically called a colt, a youngster that had never been ridden, and not just any old donkey. And the cloaks were spread on the roadway beneath the colt as it moseyed up to the Mount of Olives and then down towards Jerusalem. Also missing from Luke's gospel, but it usually featured in our Palm Sunday celebrations, are the shouts of Hosanna. What we have in Luke instead are shouts echoing the joyous strain of the psalm that was our first reading today, with one big alteration. Usually, as pilgrims made their way up to Jerusalem for the Passover in Jesus' day, they would sing that psalm, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." But on Cloak Sunday, long ago, they sang instead, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord." Well, my point in pointing out Luke's use of words cloak, colt, and king is that they all emphasize something very important about the unique identity of the one who rode into Jerusalem on that good day. In Luke's telling of the triumphal entry, the identity of Jesus as the ideal ruler of the people of Israel is emphasized. Jesus rode into town on a gentle colt, which is an animal that the prophet Zechariah, hundreds of years before Christ, said would be the sweet ride of the long-awaited Messiah. It was a colt on which the ideal king of Israel would be upon when he entered into Jerusalem. And the people in the day of Jesus were longing for this one to come in, to heal their brokenness and replace their sorrow, to establish a new realm in which people would experience the blessings of justice, peace, and prosperity. And the cloaks that Jesus sat upon and that were spread before his sweet ride, his sweet, gentle ride, were laid him just as the people laid their cloaks before the anointed kings of Israel long before. Well, according to the Gospel of Luke, Jesus rode into Jerusalem as the long-awaited king. And with the coming of this new ruler, the establishment of a new just realm was at hand. But there was a bit of a problem that day. And that Jerusalem was already part of a realm. And Jerusalem already had a ruler. At the time that Jesus entered into Jerusalem for that Passover celebration, the city and the land all around it were part of the Roman Empire. And at that region, they were ruled by the governor, Pilate, who already reigned over everything. Pilate was like all provincial governors in Rome who had experience commanding an army. And he was in charge of using a legion of soldiers to maintain order. And he did so with his soldiers, commanding them as a brutal police force. Pilate was in charge of all legal matters, and he himself functioned as the chief judge in all matters in the realm. He was in charge of extracting money from people to pay not only for his government, but to ship off wealth to Rome He was in charge of the local rulers, like the Herods, who carried out many of his programs. And he was even in charge of the religious system. The vestments, the clothing that the priests had to wear in the temple in Jerusalem, were kept under guard in a Roman fortress. And the people worshipped in the temple in Jerusalem only when allowed to do so by Pilate, who rode in from his capital on the coast a few times a year to oversee business, including religious business, and to maintain order during raucous festival times, like during the Passover, when masses of pilgrims streamed into Jerusalem from all over the place. And how different the rides must have been for Pilate and Jesus as they entered into Jerusalem on that Passover. One of them came gently, riding on a sweet young donkey. The other probably galloped in on a mighty war horse, or perhaps rode upon a war chariot. This one came into town to control people, and he kept peace by brute force. The other one, however, he came to preach about peace between people and God and one another. And he came to set people free from their destructive ways. Well, today on this palm/cloak Sunday, we should reject the way of the proud warrior Pilate and instead welcome the way of the one who comes riding as a humble prince of peace. And like his many followers who spread out their cloaks before him, we too should welcome him as the long-awaited Christ. Let us welcome him as one who reigns over our hearts and our minds. And let us join with those pilgrims of long ago that sang, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." Let us sing, "Blessed is this ruler who comes in the name of God, the God of all creation." With them, let us offer our songs of praise, our prayers for deliverance, and our humble acts of devotion. May we do so this day, throughout the coming Holy Week, and on every step of our life's journey that lies before us. Amen. And I invite all who are able to stand and join us in our second hymn, Ride On in Majesty, which is found in the Black New Century Hymnal, number 215.
Thank you.
we share with one another our joys and concerns to bring to God in prayer. And I ask for you to be keeping in prayer some of our friends and members in the coming week. Please keep in prayer Richard O. and Susan B., both of whom will have some work done on their knees shortly. We also ask for your prayers for Al S., who is in rehab locally after being hospitalized last week. Also, please be keeping in prayer Jan B., as she is recovering from pelvic fractures. We ask for you to be praying also for all in our church community living with cancer, especially Christopher and Stephen. Does anybody else have a word of joy or concern that they would like to bring to the congregation for us to be lifting up to God in prayer? Well, let us come to God now in a word of prayer. We pray to you, good and gracious God, by lifting up to you our shouts of Hosanna as well as our heartfelt prayers. Answer us, we pray, and be our salvation. Throughout times, trial, you have led us through the wilderness on paths long and toilsome. Together we follow Christ to the dark hour when he will be betrayed and broken. As our faces are turned to the cross, strengthen our wearied souls that we might continue with faithful footsteps and follow the course that he set before us. On this day long ago, Christ rode into Jerusalem and toward his death, a death to which we have been sealed in our own baptisms. Together, we are preparing to move in remembrance into the darkness of that cold and lonely tomb. And what will we find there? Is there truth to be found in the growing darkness of this week? Answer us, we pray. Become our salvation. We gather to begin Holy Week, a week, though dark and dismal, that is nevertheless a week of preparation for resurrection. A resurrection to which we have been sealed in our own baptisms. Together we are preparing to be renewed by the light of the empty tomb. And what will we find there? What truths will be discovered in the light of Easter? Answer us, we pray, and become our salvation. As we march together into Jerusalem, through Gethsemane, to the hill of the cross, we bring with us the concerns that are on our hearts this day. Be with those who cannot grasp the hope of the resurrection. Be with those who have lost loved ones and all those who struggle to sing Alleluia next Sunday. Be with those who are seeking affordable housing and health care in difficult economic times. Be with those without a voice, that their voices may be freed to proclaim your praise. Be with those who are approaching their own death, that they may be comforted by the truth of resurrection. Be with every one of us as we seek to prepare for the resurrection by remembering Christ's journey. Be with us, O God, and become our salvation. Help us to rest in the comforting truth that in life, in death, and life beyond death, we are not alone. We belong to you. Give us strength, give us courage, give us hope for the abundant and everlasting life that you have promised. Answer us, we pray, and become our salvation. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Respond to God's grace in our lives by giving ourselves to God. We give of ourselves in many ways, with our time and our talent and our treasure. Together as a congregation, we give ourselves for the good of God's work in the community and right here in our midst. And this only happens because of the generous giving of members of our congregation. Every year we have a stewardship campaign to lead us in our giving so that we can be considering how generous we might be able to be in our community with our work. And to lead us in our time of stewardship, I now invite Tim Corwin to talk about this year's campaign, Gratefully Giving.
Ken, good morning. My name is Tim Corwin. I'm a longtime member of First Church. I've actively served in many roles. For the past several years, I've served as the chair of the stewardship committee. On this committee, I'm joined by Ken and Christine McGarry, Jan Droz, Jeremy Little, and Judy Clark. It's my pleasure to introduce this year's campaign, Gratefully Giving. Over the next several weeks, you will hear from members of this church talking about what First Church means to them and why they are grateful to give their time and treasure to its mission. Now, those of you who know me, you've seen me at this lectern many times, talking about the importance of stewardship, how your money supports our institutional needs, our personnel salaries, maintenance, and upkeep of the church. Heat and electricity, yes, all those are necessary costs to keep the lights on. But there is so much more. This church, all of you, have had such a positive impact on me and my family, Sunday school, VBB, cantatas, food pantry, church fairs, and the list goes on and on. I'm grateful for all of it, and that's one of the reasons why I give. Our goal this year is to double the number of pledges. Not everyone pledges. Some give week to week. Some give for very specific reasons, and you know, perhaps we need a new boiler. And me, along with everyone on the stewardship committee, are grateful for all the ways you give. But this idea of pledging has always perplexed me a little. Pledges, why pledge? Yes, it helps Lynn, our treasurer, and all the other members of our trustees plan for the year because they have a better idea on the money coming in. But the problem with this argument is that it is grounded in our institutional needs. Perhaps the reason is enough for some people to pledge, like me. I've served on the trustees for many years. I know the importance of a budget, but I felt like there must be a better reason why people pledge. So I became curious. I found an article last night about pledging and the reasons why. I learned that an effective stewardship ministry is never about the church's needs to receive money. It's always about the giver's need to give. And I like that. It really fits our campaign's name, Gratefully Giving. God wants each of us to experience the joy of generosity. Pledging helps us embrace the spiritual discipline of giving. I've never thought about it that way, but when I read that last night, it really changed the way I think about pledging. Embracing the spiritual discipline of giving. Like prayer, scripture reading, dedication of service, the practice of giving regularly and intentionally helps us grow in faith and mature spiritually. It requires us to put our needs and wants into proper perspective, to set aside our own interests for the sake of God and others. Generosity is a tool God uses to shape our hearts. Pledging helps us grow in generosity. So throughout the next several weeks, please take time to reflect on how you give to the church. If you don't pledge yet, I encourage you to consider it. Give it some thought. Ask questions. Please reach out to me or anyone else on the committee to learn more. You will hear from members of our church community and learn about the good work we are doing. We hope that you will commit to support our work by pledging on Stewardship Sunday, May 15th. Let us give greatly, let us give fully, and let us give gratefully. Thank you.
Thank you. If Jesus Christ is to reign among us, much more will be needed than our praise and rejoicing when we are together. How do we witness and serve when we are apart? How much of ourselves and our substance will we invest? We ask these questions as we give together generously to support our church. And as is our tradition still, we receive offerings when you come and when you go. We thank you for your generous giving.
I'll sing this song, sing this anthem in Korean and Spanish because it doesn't have official English lyrics. So I will tell you briefly about the English translation before I sing. I kneel at the Lord's feet. I'm surrounded by His love. Either any words or voices become still and quiet at His feet. The Lord, my love, when I sit at His feet, all my hopes and prayers become the songs of love. Touching the hem of His clothes, washing and wiping His feet, kissing on the feet of my Savior, I will put my crown right there.
Thank you.
Together, let us offer our unison prayer of dedication. Grateful for your grace that is new every morning, and thankful that the gates of righteousness are open to us, we bring our gifts to your altar, O God. We dedicate our offerings and ourselves, that the reign of Jesus Christ may be realized and celebrated wherever Christians gather to worship and everywhere we scatter to serve. May every knee bow at the name of Jesus and every tongue confess that Christ is the world's salvation. May the needs of all your children be addressed by those who confess Jesus Christ. Amen. Our final hymn this morning is number 304 in the Black New Century Hymnal, "All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name." Service here in this room comes to an end, your service in the world outside begins. And as you go, may God, who is your creator, redeemer, and sustainer, go with you and grant you peace.